In partnership with 105.9 Seaside FM, Land Force Atlantic Area's Information Operations Branch present Backstage with the Dartmouth Players, a half-hour special that will acquaint you with the local theater group that's celebrating its 25th anniversary season this year. I'm Corporal Tyler Munford, joined by Master Corporal Ari Narjarian. We interviewed three different members of the Dartmouth Players who offered three unique perspectives on the organization. Here are actor Jim Petrie, building manager Angus Duncan, and current president of Dartmouth Players, Eric Jordan.
Well, I'd like to start by telling you that this is Dartmouth Players' 25th anniversary, and for that anniversary they decided to bring back four of their most famous plays. They just done The Best Little Whorehouse in Texas. The second play is this play, Run for Your Wife. And of course they got Please Come Back to the Five and Dine, Jimmy Dean. And the final one will be Dracula. That will be the whole season.
The mission of Dartmouth Players is to bring the magic of live theater to the residents of HRM. We're a non-profit organization. We run completely by very talented volunteers. We have expenses, so we pay the expenses, and that's why we have to charge.
Community theater is what Dartmouth Players is all about. We're a theater by the community, for the community. We're entirely volunteer-driven. There's no salaries are paid, and everyone from the community is welcome to take part, either as a patron or as a volunteer.
Dartmouth Players have been around in one form or another for 25 years. For the past 12 of those years, Angus Duncan has been a volunteer with the theater group.
We started back in the 60s, and the players presented their plays in high schools and dinner theaters because they didn't actually have a theater to act in. When they went to high school, they did their acting in a gymnasium. So they set up, did their play, and when they finished the play, they had to take it apart to make the gymnasium available for the students the next day. So it was quite a lot of work.
After over a decade as the Dartmouth Drama Club, the theater group changed its name to Dartmouth Players in 1971, and in 1974 moved into its very first dedicated building, the Dundas Cinema. However, this was short-lived. After just one production of Dark of the Moon, the Dundas Street Theater burned down. Unable to continue with no equipment or stage, the Dartmouth Players disbanded that year. Fortunately, that's not the end of the story.
So anyway, they started doing theater again. They put on a play in Halifax. Mayor John Savage just happened to be in the audience for one of their plays. And after the play, he said, "Why aren't you in Dartmouth?" And they said, "We don't have a place to play." So he looked around and did a lot of work. He found the building for them. This building belonged to St. Peter's Church. It used to be the old St. Peter's School. So the building is rented to HRM, and now HRM asked us to form a society, and it's the Creighton Community Center Society. We look after the management of the building for HRM. So I'm part of the society. We have been in here all about 25 years or more. And here in the theater, up on the third floor, we have three classrooms. And we've named them, one's the Twillo Room, one's the Tyner Room, and one's the Circum Room. Now, Flo Twillo has been with this theater almost since the beginning, along with Cliff and Val Tyner. And we actually refer to them as Mr. and Mrs. Dartmouth Players. And Dick Circum does a lot of magic here at the theater to make props and so on. It makes a lot of things work.
As a community-based theater group, Dartmouth Players relies on a vibrant relationship with organizations, businesses, and the wider public in the Dartmouth area. This relationship goes both ways. Set and costume designer Isabel Terrio, stage manager John Beard, president Eric Jordan, and actor Angus Duncan share their insights about the role of their theater group in the local community.
It's open to everyone. It's like Cheers, right? Everybody knows who you are. Everybody can come in and just hang out and come to the shows, and you can mingle with the cast afterwards, right? Like, you can meet the people who just put on the amazing production. You can meet the people who did everything. So that's always fun. So it's a huge community thing. It's all about meeting people and bringing people together.
For what it costs to come here, I mean, it's really reasonable. You can't really buy that cheap of entertainment. And I mean, it is entertainment. The folks who come here, we hardly ever get any bad reviews. The people are lifetime members. They've been coming here. Some of these are people who will come here for this show will recognize it from 20 years ago. It's just fantastic. I mean, the community itself, the building is a community building, and we rent and perform out of here. But because it's open to anybody, anybody can come in from the community. So it gets people seeing each other, you know, community spirit. It's great.
We have a community involvement performance every play where the proceeds for one night's performance go to a community charity or cause. So we pick groups like Grannies for Grannies in Africa are supported by one of our plays, as well as other groups like choral groups and drama groups, and of course now Seaside FM. We will provide a scholarship for a student or two who are going on to further their education in theater arts. We have a scholarship fund that they can apply to, and if they're chosen, they will receive a scholarship from Dartmouth Players.
We do give a scholarship to a high school girl and boy in Dartmouth who will be continuing on in the arts. It's $1,000 scholarship now each. It used to be $500. We put it up to $1,000.
A lot of work goes into producing a play or musical. Without knowing a whole lot about theater, it's difficult to appreciate all the different roles, responsibilities, and tasks involved. From direction to stage management to set and costume design, special effects, and the actual acting, we asked members of the Dartmouth Players to offer us a glimpse into their unique responsibilities.
Stage manager, I have to make sure all the folks are here on time. Once the director's done and we have opening night, that's about the last time the director will be here. Then the show solely rests on my shoulders. So anything goes wrong with timing, set, the people, anything, it's all on me. So it's actually a busier job because once the show actually opens, Mike Tobin can walk away and he doesn't come back until the last show. And that's only for the party. So the run is, it's a stressful spot, but it's what I've asked to do. So,
My name's Mike. I'm directing Run for Your Wife. Directing is kind of a mix of a lot of things, right? You have to have an understanding of the script, right? You have to have your own interpretation and how you want to proceed with it. You have to work with the actors and help them find their characters. You have to, work with your cast and crew and bring everybody together, right? So you have to kind of oversee the set design and the set construction and the lighting and, you know, every department, right? You know, everything's a fundamental in it, right? Also, producing wise is kind of a neat thing as well, because you get to manage the budget for the show. You have to find people, you know, to volunteer in this case, you know, and help put the show together, right?
I'm Andrew Finnegan, and I'm the technical director here at Dartmouth Players, and yeah, I do a lot of the lighting and set design. Technical director, you basically, you're overseeing all the other departments within, that are in charge of technical production. So carpentry, lighting, sound, costumes, and then you've got special effects. And then you got to think of the other stuff too, like stage management and whatnot, all kind of falls under your umbrella. And you're kind of just the liaisons to make sure that everyone works together and plays nice, I guess.
My name is Jim Petrie. I play the character of Stanley Gardner. I am an annoying upstairs neighbor to John Smith and his wife Mary, who live at 25 Kenilworth Avenue. And John is also married to Barbara, who lives in 47 Lewin Road in another part of London. So he's trying to keep that a secret. And he just tells me at the beginning of the play what the situation is, because he helped an old lady. He's a taxi driver, and he helped an old lady who was being mugged by two muggers. Police bring him home, and the press is on their way to take his picture. And he doesn't want the picture in the papers because his other wife will find out that he's actually married to a different woman. So him and I try to conceal the fact that he's a bigamist.
My name's Isabel Terrio. I do pretty much everything, anything they need done. I like to help out with set and stuff because my dad taught me how to build things when I was younger and my mother taught me how to sew. So that's I've been doing costumes for this because I came back in the middle of the season from Montreal. I was in Montreal for a year and so didn't really have a whole lot left. I'm stage managing the next show. And yeah, so that's pretty much it. We're planning on completely taking the inventory of the entire costume room sometime within the next couple weeks. It's going to be good fun.
As a not-for-profit organization with limited fundraising capability, the Dartmouth Players are faced with constant budgetary constraints. Members have become accustomed to finding creative solutions to challenging problems in set and costume design, lighting, and special effects. And they've become quite good at it. Technical Director Andrew Finnegan reflects on some of these challenges.
In the past, I don't know whether it's been done before, but I mean, since I've gotten here and with dealing with a lot of the other people, we try to do things for the least amount of money we can, but at the same time get a really good product out of it. And like the set for this show is a really good example. The entire set is basically designed around stock material that we had within our collection. And then a lot of the other materials are either recycled from old shows or literally built out of garbage. In the case of our fireplace is literally built out of garbage. And then a lot of the painting effects and whatnot, we've mimicked a finish rather than paying for the actual product, which a lot of times is going to be way more expensive than just trying to fake it. So it's working so far. One of the big challenges of kind of working in this space is because a lot of the equipment and whatnot has been donated, there isn't, like in the professional environment, everything is kind of streamlined to work together and designed that way. Whereas in the volunteer environment, you get materials and equipment sometimes that are donated and sometimes it's difficult to get them to play well together. But I mean, for the most part, we do a good job, and being technical director here, it's kind of one of my major problems is trying to figure out how to actually get that done. And so far with working with the other people here, we have been fairly successful. And then we've got like our tech geniuses like Dick Circum, who can basically make anything work, and if he can't make it work, it probably will not work. Because I've given him some really weird designs and he's turned around and said, oh well, give me a week, and then he returns with some machine that does everything you want and more, and it's kind of like, how did you think of that? I know he's got an engineering background, but a lot of people, he's just kind of a man of mystery and a mad scientist inventor, but it all works out. He knows his stuff and he's really good at what he does. So
considerable praise for volunteer Dick Circum from technical director Andrew Finnegan. We approached the longtime set builder, technical wizard, and current member at large to see what he had to say about his years of experience backstage with the Dartmouth Players.
I'm a retired electrical engineer. I just wandered in off the street and, what do you want to do? And I said, oh, well, I can do some work on the stage if you like. So they gave me a great big hamper that they wanted to hide somebody in. So they've often required special effects. For example, several plays back, they wanted an actor to come in a state of great agitation and start firing a gun off in all directions. And we wanted this to shatter a vase of flowers and trip a cuckoo clock off into going. And it all had to be quite carefully synchronized a convincing-looking special effect. That was the sort of thing I've been doing for quite some time.
So far this segment, we've introduced you to the Dartmouth Players and discussed the theater group's involvement in the community. We've also taken a glimpse backstage to hear some of the members speak about their work directly. This Monday is the next opportunity to see a production put on by the Dartmouth Players. Director Mike Tobin talks about the theater group's latest undertaking, which has been in the works since November.
For Dartmouth Players' 25th anniversary,
we decided to bring back one of our greatest hit farces back to the stage, Ray Cooney's Run for Your Wife. This show was originally directed by Dartmouth Players past president and co-founder Cliff Tyner, with the help of his wife Valerie. Valerie recalls the show as being one of the first to completely sell out, a show so popular that special arrangements were made so the former Premier of Nova Scotia could get squeezed in for a seat. The Tyners have been involved in nearly every season of Dartmouth Players, and we gratefully dedicate this show to them. It takes a special breed of actor to deliver the demanding timing, energy, and character that a farce requires. Ray Cooney has a talent for writing farces which are believable in a completely nonsensical fashion. His storylines, though somewhat complex, contain simple, grounded individuals put through extraordinary circumstances. In a recent interview, he notes that his successful comedies come from first creating a strong, dramatic starting point, then twisting it into obscurity. Watching our actors take on these challenging roles has been a great pleasure. Every week brought a new transformation. We hope you will find Run for Your Wife as riotously entertaining as our audiences did nearly 20 years ago. We actually started, when did we start? I think we started rehearsals in November, so we did the auditions at the very end of October, actually, and we started doing rehearsals. We do 3 rehearsals a week, usually 3 hours in length each, right? And we do those right through from, November right up until February when the show starts. Editions are always open. They're on our website to let you know of it. They're released in our newsletter as well that goes out to lots of people. Also, I typically use Kijiji and Twitter and all the social stuff as additional outlets to promote a show if I'm putting one on or whatever, right? Really, there is no experience necessary. I mean, we have a guy on our stage whose first time acting was this year in the last show we did. And he's on for a second time. So we've had people completely green to theater walk in and do roles. We have some very experienced people as well. And it's great to get a good mix of people. So we encourage anybody, if you never did theater in your life, to walk through the door and just try it out, right?
Dartmouth Players' current production of Run for Your Wife, with its first performance scheduled this Monday evening, promises to be hugely entertaining. Members of the theater group discuss the production and the methods by which they engage and involve the audience over the course of the performance.
John Smith, the main character, he's married to 2 wives in 2 different towns. And everything's kind of happily going along. He kind of keeps the wives on a really tight schedule until he gets beat up by some mongers and gets thrown off his schedule. He's a taxi driver. So basically, he has to kind of try to lie and find his way out of this mess. Now, things get additionally messed up with his upstairs neighbor, Stanley, at one of the 2 flats, a gay dressmaker at the other, and 2 police officers. So it's a farce. It's a fast-paced comedy and just kind of intended to entertain everyone, right?
It's cool to just come and watch the shows because you can just see what the final production is, the end. And we always do a musical and a farce, and then we do 2 other shows, a drama. And so this is the farce that we're working on right now. We usually cut off during the summer. And Susie comes in and does day camps. She goes weeks at a time with the kids. We have people who are season ticket holders. They come to every show. The apartment building next door is a seniors apartment building, and they like to come in on Sundays because we have a 2 o'clock show on Sundays. And that's good too because a lot of people don't like to come in at 8 o'clock at night and stay till 10. It's a little late for a weeknight. I'm used to it because I'm always here, but some people, past 9 o'clock, it's like, okay, I'm too tired. I just want to go home. So we have two matinees per run. And I think it's good because there's always something for everybody. There's always a musical, so you can come in and see people singing and dancing. There's always a farce like this one, which is just hilarious the whole way through. And then there's always a drama or two, which kind of just some people are more into that. So there's something for everybody.
Come on out and have a laugh. And if you've never seen Dartmouth Players, it is a quaint little theater. It's beautiful. They when I came in here tonight, Eric Jordan, who was tacking up another poster of a play that we've just completed, The Best Little Horror House in Texas. He's tacking that onto the wall. It's like an alumni of plays we've done here. You will sit down and watch this play, and you'll wonder, it's Dartmouth's best-kept secret, Dartmouth Players. If you haven't been here, you need to just come spend $15, $17, I think a seat will cost you, and come and enjoy the play, and I guarantee you, you'll leave happy, and you'll ask yourself why you've never been here. And you'll have a laugh, because my role is to make you laugh. That's what I like to do, make people laugh. That's why I'm in the theater.
Every intermission at Dartmouth Players, we have a prize or two donated by our sponsors, and we give these away as store prizes at our intermission. Our patrons love the quiz that we have for them in every program, and they enjoy the draws. Seaside FM, of course, is one of our sponsors, but we have many local businesses in Dartmouth. For example, Janice Weber, the physiotherapist, advertises with us, as do many local restaurants and businesses, real estate agents, and so on. Local community people who are involved with the community and who help community theater by supporting us. We have to put on a high-quality performance so people buy tickets and come here.
You can get tickets at ticketpro.ca. You go to their website, and you can just buy the tickets online, pick the show you want to see. There's 14 performances running from February 6th to 26th, Wednesday to Saturday at 8 o'clock, and we have matinee shows on Sunday at 2 o'clock.
Over the past 20 minutes, we've learned about the history of Dartmouth Players, shed some light on their involvement with the community, and gain some insight about what it's like behind the scenes. We've also promoted their current production of Run for Your Wife, with its inaugural performance this Monday evening. What we haven't discussed is a theater group's ongoing efforts to encourage volunteerism. As longtime volunteer Angus Duncan reminds us, Dartmouth Players' mission is to bring the magic of live theater to the residents of HRM. And as the members of a theater group will attest, this mission is realized each time they inspire a newcomer to participate in a production.
To put on a play is a very large expenditure of energy. For example, just from the very beginning, you have to get the rights to the play, which involves communication with a company like French's in New York, where you have to buy the rights to perform, and then you have to get a cast. Well, first you have to get someone who'll direct it. Then you have to get a cast. Then you have to arrange rehearsals, and you have to design a set, and then you have to build a set, and then you have to light the set, and then you have to design the set. Then you have to get your actors on stage. Then you have to get everything going, and then you have to sell tickets.
You can learn so much from coming into this place and trying different things, right? You'll learn about yourself. You learn about how to work with others, get along, and really just grow. I mean, a lot of people, will ask why. You know, you might spend so much time in a theater doing something for free, right? We spend, our volunteers will spend like anywhere from, 10 to 40 hours a week in here, right? Putting a show together. So it's a huge commitment, right? It really is. But what's rewarding, I guess, is the end product, seeing a show get on stage and seeing people enjoy it and just getting the experience and garnering the confidence to do something bigger and bolder the next time, right? You know? So a big experience thing, I'd say, and just a lot of fun working with people. Well, just enjoy it, right? It's fun.
It's my happy place. I used to act when I was a kid, but I mean, I've been involved in theater since I was like 3. So it's kind of part of my life. And I was in Montreal for a year and I didn't do it for a whole year and I went completely insane. I was like, okay, I can't do this anymore. I gotta go home.
Having a volunteer that's willing to learn is worth more than actually having a qualified person. Because lots of times you get stuck into kind of complacency if you've done it enough times. So if you have someone that's just brand new to the game, they bring a lot of enthusiasm to the table, which a lot of times is worth more than the actual experience. So for this show, for example, we had a woman who, she auditioned for one of the roles, and she didn't end up getting the role, but she came in a few times to paint, and she was amazed with the painting techniques we were using and how they actually turned out. But she seemed to have a really fun time doing it all, and hopefully she will become a regular here.
There's a lot of folks that actually make up the behind-the-scenes thing, from prop people to set dressing, to folks that are standing by for quick changes. In this play particularly, there's a couple of scenes where the ladies have to be in and out of, say, night clothes to real dresses. There's people there to help them because there's just no time. There's literally five lines in between that. And then you go as far as actors get hungry, so halfway through the show, we get food delivered in, and that's all the girls upstairs, girls and guys upstairs that run front of house, and they're fantastic. They sell all our tickets. They check the tickets at the door. It's an amazingly big thing, and those are where the volunteers really come in because they constantly need people. It's a semi-thankless job, in my opinion, but they just do a wonderful job. Without them, we wouldn't have the seats filled like we do. And again, with the folks, and then in intermission, they sell all the food, do the draws. There's people who do advertising, who go out and get sponsors for prizes for the intermissions every night we're on, which is a fair undertaking. I mean, these are things, again, I do not want to do, but there's people that do them here, and they do them very well, and they're constantly doing it and looking for more people to help. And then on top of that, the people at the front of the house, we have folks that make our posters, take our pictures for the posters, set up our programs, the whole bit. And those people, again, it's semi-thankless, but they certainly do a wonderful job, and we try and acknowledge them every chance we get, especially during intermissions. But other than that, again, it's them that makes everything, because the actors, they come and go, but those people are always here, you know. If I pick the front of house person, it's Anne Marie, and then her son, Andrew, and her daughter, they come here constantly, and they do pictures, and they do sound, and they set up things, and they know more about this theater. They've been coming here since they were children, and now they go through school for music and photography and all these good things, and they bring that right back into their community here at Dartmouth Players. So it's commendable, really.
Come on, it's see to play. Dartmouth Players is always looking for volunteers. If you think that you have talent as an actor, this is the place to test it. You don't need any experience. You come out for a rehearsal, maybe you get a small part in a play, and then you'll learn how to act. And that's what I did. I never started acting until I was like, I'm 54 now. This is 6 plays I've done in about 7 or 8 years. So I started here about when I was 45. Just thought I had a talent in this regard. And if you think you have a talent in an area, you owe it to yourself to develop that talent. And if you want to come out and volunteer, even not as an actor, we have many people here that work back scenes, building sets, doing props, stage managing, assistant stage managing. We are always looking for people here at Dartmouth Players, and they're very, very nice people, and I'm sure you'll enjoy yourself here. So yeah, come on out, see the play, and maybe volunteer and help Dartmouth Players become a little more well known.
I think this is a fantastic theater, great opportunity for anybody who wants to get involved with theater and they didn't think they could. They can. Anybody can. It's simple. I walked in off the street with really virtually no experience, and I've never stopped coming back. I've been involved in every production since I started here, and most of the same people have been as well. It's great. So the more the merrier, and doors are always open for new talent.
This morning, we became acquainted with the Dartmouth Players, a not-for-profit theater group with ties to the community stretching back to the 1960s and 70s. Their second of 4 productions this season is Ray Cooney's farce, Run for Your Wife, which begins its 14-performance run on Monday evening. The all-volunteer cast and supporting crew encourage you to attend their 25th anniversary performance while you still can. As well, consider volunteering some of your time to help make their next production another great success. You can learn more about the Dartmouth Players online at www.dartmouthplayers.ns.ca, where you can also subscribe to their monthly newsletter and connect with them on Facebook.
This has been a special presentation of Backstage with the Dartmouth Players, produced by Land Force Atlantic Area's Information Operations Branch in partnership with 105.9 Seaside FM. Corporal Tyler Munford and Master Corporal Ari Narjarian thank you for joining us and return you to your regularly scheduled Saturday programming.